today. I'm with my co-host, of course. We do a lot of stuff together. Hey, Jim, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing, Sarah?
I'm hanging in there. I think that's all we all can do, right? So today we have a special guest on the show, and she has been a fan as long as I've been a fan, as far as I can tell. And she's been around the Facebook groups for a long time. She's up there for the most concerts. I'm not sure who has the most concerts, but I know that you're up there at the top. It may be Katie Couric, between Katie Couric, you, and Jim, I think, right? Is that correct?
I'm not sure. I think Katie Couric got a reputation for going to a lot of concerts, but she's not actually in the top running, but there are a few others out of Pomona.
Okay, yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
So we're super excited to have her on the show, and just say hi to Lyn Smith. Hey, Lyn, how are you?
I'm great. How are you guys doing?
I'm doing wonderful. How you doing, Lyn?
I'm good. Good, Jim. Good to hear you.
Yes.
Jim just ate ice cream. He's happy. So how are you doing? Tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, where you're from and things like that.
Okay. I'm from Southeast Michigan, right outside of Detroit. I've, like you said, been a fan of Scarypoolparty music since day one. Love going to shows. Love all the people I've met in the whole community. Some really, really good people, and made some really good friends through the whole thing. Yeah, it's been great.
Awesome. Yeah, it's been it's funny, it's hard to believe it's like over a year now. Like, we're into year number two. It feels like it's been 10 years. And that wasn't a joke, because it really does feel like it's been 10 years sometimes.
I was about to add and counting, but you beat me to it.
And counting, yes. So the first question on our standard thing is, why do you love Scarypoolparty? Which I know is a really hard question for people sometimes, but we would love to know your thoughts.
Well, it's funny because I think about, you know, his music is so diverse. How can you pick one thing you love about it? But there is one thing that permeates all the music, whether it's, you know, guitar, piano, songwriting, composing, and it's really honest. It just comes from a really pure, honest place. And it's just a nice flow of honest energy from wherever this music comes from. I'd love to go visit there sometime. Sounds great. But yeah, that's what it is. It's just really honest.
I feel the same way. I just read a blog article today about that. And I was like, it feels real to me. It's good and it's bad. And there's ups and there's downs. But it's real. It's not some, I don't know, Instagram pretty fan relationship, but the music is real and it's beautiful, and I think a lot of good things come from real emotion.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'm a believer that all the emotions are good, whether they feel good at the time or not, and it's really nice to listen to music that channels all of them in such a pure way.
I really love that answer, Lyn. The one that I was forming in my head as she asked the question was authenticity, and it's basically the same thing. Something that we would expect from a singer-songwriter. And quite frankly, a lot of people try to be singer-songwriters, and yet they still don't carry with them that same authenticity. And for me, I saw it immediately, and I was sold immediately.
But you have to wonder how much of that is the music industry, because I think that there are a lot of real artists out there, but I think that the music industry kind of forces them, much like American Idol originally did with him, right? They wanted him to be in this box and sing covers. So I don't know that it's the artist as much as it is the industry expectations.
You might be right. I mean, you know, pop music, people like pop music, pop being popular. You know, it's music that is popular with the masses, and he doesn't necessarily want to do that.
I think people in general, and this is a sweeping generalization, they tend to like what they like, and they don't have a broad spectrum of things that they enjoy, you know, musically or artistically or whatever. So when you have someone like Scarypoolparty who covers like the whole spectrum, there's something for everyone, but there's always going to be someone who, you know, isn't crazy about something. And I think that's why they try and put people in a box, you know, to appeal to like one group. So if you can get one group, you know, then you can make money off of that.
So true.
Yeah,
I've considered a lot of the music industry since I've started following him, because it was painful for him, and I know that it was. Like, we all know that Idol was painful for him, and he wanted to quit. But I do think that the judges kind of saw something that they wanted to work towards. And watching the show this year, it's a totally different show, first of all. And somebody pointed out to me that it's all singer-songwriters this year. And I was like, that is kind of true, with the exception of maybe Louis Knight and Just Sam, who I think have a very big pop potential. The rest, the kind of top seven, are all singer-songwriters, and I always compare them to him. But I think that he changed a lot already as far as expectations, and I think that's only going to continue to grow as we get to know him. I can't wait for the next album, because it was supposed to be acoustic, and then he was talking about death metal or something. I was like, okay, well, that's not exactly what we thought was coming, but I'm open, I'm game, I don't care.
It's going to be a scary pool party album, so it's going to be a big surprise, and it's going to cover, you know, the whole spectrum, which I love. I love that. I love that about his music.
I do, too. I love that I can listen to different songs in different moods, and if I'm in, like, you know, a God American Guns mood, I can listen to that kind of stuff. So, I don't know, I love it.
Yes, I can answer that. People have asked me on and off what kind of music I like, and I say good music.
Yeah, music.
And let's face it, if, I mean, jazz is, it's rocking, I'm listening. If the music, whatever genres, does it successfully, the ear responds. What can I say? Now, not everyone's like that. You know, we look for good, solid handholds in ways that we can identify ourselves, or, you know, we like something that, we like to keep it simple, I think, as humans, and we do stick to one kind of music, and we're really missing out.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's what shows like American Idol, you know, have always gone for. You know, the viewer or the listener who has a specific taste, and they want to fulfill that taste, you know. And I love the fact that people are opening up more to, you know, new and different genres of music through people like Scaryfanparty. I mean, who would have put, you know, piano with, like, industrial music, you know, with some beautiful, you know, classical composition in it. I mean, it's fabulous.
I was about to say, it seems like he was, in exit form, he was trying to introduce people to all of his varied interests, you know, really by infusing those things which are most universal in them, is his piano playing that everyone responded to, and the guitar songs. It just seems like he wanted to have a fan base and an audience of people that appreciate every angle of him. And I think he's actually found success, if you ask me. Our fan clubs are filled with people who are waiting for anything that comes down, whether it's electronic, punk, alternative, don't matter.
And I think it just goes back to that honest energy that he puts into the music. So it doesn't matter what genre it is. I mean, I'm not crazy about country music, but I think if Scaryfanparty put out a country song, if it was honest and pure with that energy, I'd love it. I'd be all about it, you know?
Amen. I was just saying that the other day to somebody, actually, about I could see him doing country. I could absolutely see him doing country. Like, I think he will conquer any style that he basically wants to, like jazz. I think the jazz he did, I loved it. I'm a big New Orleans person. I'm moving to New Orleans. So I love that genre of music. And, you know, that music that he did was amazing. And I think he could do country. I think he has done rap. We saw that. I'm waiting patiently for the rap album to come out because I thought it was awesome. I don't know who he thought would actually take him on, but although there were a couple people, it was fun. But, you know, I think he'll do whatever he wants, basically. Yep. And people are getting used to it slowly but surely, but it has been a wild ride so far. So can you tell us what your favorite song is? And why?
My favorite one song? Oh my gosh, seriously? That's like asking, which one of your kids do you love the most? the song that first was my favorite song was, I'm not going to name the whole thing, but the 2340 song on SoundCloud, 2340927352, you know. That song to me, it sounds like a thousand, like, chanting monks. You know, it's just got this energy about it, and it just resonates. His vocals do, just all of the reverb that he uses in it, the synth. It's just, I don't know, I can't even describe how that song makes me feel. It's really, like, transcending. So I absolutely love that. And then I got to put in props for Beneath the Skin, because I think that song is amazing. I've loved that since I first heard it when he had it up, or someone had it up as Alone, way back when. So, yeah. But when he, you know, when we first started hearing about him, I found all the music pretty quickly. So it was nice to see all the different aspects of him right away. And I never really got stuck in that he does only this kind of lane that a lot of people did.
And it's funny you mention that, because the one thing that the people that have been on the Facebook groups for a long time, that is one of the things we have in common, is that we all discovered his music, like, immediately. Mm-hmm. But there are people that just watched the show that didn't go on Facebook, and Facebook has its issues, I'm not saying that. But the good thing about it was that we all had this, like, dialed-in thing with his music on SoundCloud and with his music on Instagram. And, like, you kind of got to see that process. Whereas American Idol people that just watched the show, I still see people in lives and stuff going, oh, my God, you're that guy from American Idol. I've been looking for you everywhere. And they don't realize that he goes by Scarypoolparty, or they haven't seen his music. Mm-hmm. Who did we do the podcast with, Jim, that didn't know about SoundCloud? Who was that?
I'm not sure. Did Kix?
Maybe it was Kix. It might have been Kix, because Kix doesn't really investigate out stuff. Right. It might have been him. But yeah, he was like, oh, I didn't know about it. And I'm like, well, there's, like, you know, 400 some songs out there for you to explore and get to know. So yeah, I felt the same exact way.
You know what? Alejandro may need to put out that alternative album now that he's promised an acoustic album and possibly another hardcore album. Maybe just needs to throw out an alternative album and remind people that he's got some of his most unique sounds tucked away there on SoundCloud and on Broken Images. I want to answer that question too. Okay. I hate to do this to you, Lyn, but I'm going to have to agree with you. The number song has stood the test of time. Here I am a year later, and I just voted for it for the Scaryfanparty radio show for Friday. It's the first one I clicked on, and there's a reason for that. Also, high on the list, No Puedo Viva Sin Ti. Did I say that right?
No, that's excellent.
Yeah, I think that was right.
I mean, they're all good. How do you choose? I mean, you know, it's like my favorite one, which is, you know, 0.0001% better than my second favorite one. I mean, how can, you know, they're just all so good.
Agreed, but that the percentages of how one scores over another is going to change tomorrow anyway. So, you know, a month ago, I had a completely different song, and it will be that way again.
I imagine, though, I don't know, but I imagine that's how his musical brain works, all over the place all the time, you know, and I think that's why there's so much diversity in the music, because he just puts it all together, you know, in one song. He's thinking, you know, of jazz and classical and acoustic and everything all at the same time. I mean, I could just be making stuff up, but
I just stopped doing my favorites, and I now have different lists for every category, and that way I get 21 favorites instead of one. So I stopped. Like, this is my favorite rap song. This is my favorite industrial song. This is, like, I have a list of songs because there's just too many. And like I wrote in the blog today, like, you know, they're all my favorites. And none of them, and Jim said this in our last podcast, I believe, that there's just no throwaway music with him. Like, there's nothing he puts out that I'm like, you know what? I could live without it. There's ones that stand out more, like, you know, Cheeseburger Rocks. I love and have always loved that song. And I truly cannot wait for him to release it, because it's, to me, the perfect melody, the perfect lyrics. It's about, you know, falling in love. And I just, I don't know. That sign just makes me take a deep breath and sigh. Like, it just does that. But there's no throwaway music. In his massive arsenal of songs, there is not a song that I would say, it's okay. You can just delete that off the album. I can't do it. I can't.
Very true.
So, I don't know. It's interesting. It's an interesting journey as far as music, because the further you get in, the kind of deeper you go, I feel like. Like, you start off with Out Loud, right? And then you're like...
Well, yeah. It's funny because, I mean, I know this is down your list of questions. I don't know if you want me to talk about something that's down your list of questions already. But, you know, talking about, like, when we all first heard him, which was on American Idol, obviously. But, I mean, I found YouTube and SoundCloud within an hour and a half of seeing him on American Idol. So I was listening to SoundCloud while he was doing, you know, the initial American Idol. So I really latched on to all those different parts of him right away, which I was, that's what made me crazy. I was like, I can't believe you find a new song. This is him too. Find another new song. Are you kidding me? You know, something totally different. He does this too. You know, it was just like this constant just wave of just greatness, you know. Oh, it was awesome. Awesome journey.
And it never ceases. I mean, that's the thing with him. Like, you sometimes feel like you're going through a lot with him because of his authenticity. But the payoff in the end is always music that you're just like, I didn't think. Yeah. So I remember going to the New York show, and this was, the New York show was amazing, right? It was so good. He was... Mm-hmm. He was unbelievable in concert there. And I walked out, I'm like, there is no way that Philly is going to be better than New York. There's just no way. There's nothing he can do to make that show more perfect. And I literally talked to Jim after the Philly show, and we were both speechless. Because he did. Yeah. Like, he managed, he did the unplugged version of 10 years. And I mean... Talk about 2,000 people completely silent, which, by the way, never happens at one of his concerts. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable.
I mean, you know, I've been to a lot of shows, and they all have something unique about them. He always does something in every show that just makes you go, wow, that was amazing. You know, and it's different every time. The first time I saw him was acoustic in Chicago, and that was, that was pin drop. Absolute pin drop silence, you know.
So did you go to the Lollapalooza show, the pre-show?
I went to the pre-show, yeah. That was, I think, I would say that was my favorite show, oh God, for right now, because he rolled out all that new music, and it was such a surprise. Nobody expected that.
Nobody.
And we were just like, oh my God. And it was so exciting because you could tell he was in it, you know, he was in it. And it just felt good to see him just like break free and do something so different and have it be so well received. Yeah, that was awesome. That was awesome.
I would have loved to be at that show. I mean, I watched it. I was at work and I'm like trying to watch Lollapalooza while I'm at work. And it was crazy. And I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, I knew. Yeah. I knew though. We all knew. In the groups, we knew he was capable of it. Because you couldn't listen to his other music and not know that. But that was probably the most thrilling concert. Mm-hmm. That I've ever watched with him, because it was just that prolific. And the jump, I mean, we got the jump, right? The jump will go down in history.
Yeah, the jump was up. Yeah, that was good. Yeah, well, on the pre-show, he almost fell on us, and that was fun, too. When he rolled out Diamonds, which wasn't titled at the time. Yeah, he almost fell right on us, and it was crazy.
I remember, I think we have a meme with it, actually, or a gif with it, with him almost falling on you guys.
It was good.
So what's your favorite show, Jim? out of the live shows.
If you would have fallen on you, Lyn, it would have been
therapy.
It would have been complete therapy. Because all through, you know, May and June and July, it's like we kind of sense that he had a statement to make.
Yeah.
He needed to get up on stage and finally be the person in the center and do exactly what he wanted to do. Of course, I didn't expect music the way it came out, but that was definitely a fist up in the air moment. And I was just kind of exulting alongside him. I remember watching the video going, absolutely, yes. No, I didn't expect it. Yes, you did surprise me. Yes,
yeah.
I'm so happy that he finally had that chance to stand up and be who he wanted to be.
Yep, yeah. I think it gave him the freedom to just do whatever he wants, to do an acoustic show if he wants to, and know that, you know, it's not always expected of him. I think that's it, that we don't know what to expect, and that's great, you know, that's wonderful. Part of him is that you're always surprised.
Yeah, one of my favorite things that Speak said about him when we talked to Speaks in the podcast was that, you know, when he met him, it was like, well, what genre do you play? And he's like, Scarypoolparty is the genre. And I was like, wow, he says that himself. Like, that to me is cool because it kind of makes me feel like he's always been who he is. Mm-hmm. And I like that he managed to hold on to that through Idol, you know? Like, it just makes me feel good about it, so.
He just embodies the spirit of music, so that's why I don't think it matters. As long as he believes in what he's doing, then it's good.
That was the most amazing statement ever. He embodies the spirit of music. I love that. I'm going to use that on a picture this week.
I love that, too. You know what? He actually embodies, you know, the spirit of art.
Yes.
I mean, in the larger sense, in his authenticity, I mean, that is a true artist. And if I saw someone with Alejandro's approach to expressing himself in the fine arts world, I think I would be equally enthralled.
Yep. Yeah, that's what speaks to everyone. It's that. That's the magic.
Absolutely.